Okay. So welcome everybody to this Bhutan journey to free software. I have to apologize first in name of Pema Gele, who was supposed to attend the conference but could not because of visa problems. So I had to improvise something in his name and on his behalf with the help of Franz Pop. Why both of us? Because both of us went once to Bhutan to, in some occasion, I talk more about in this talk, and help them and help to the launch of their national distribution. Okay, so Bhutan, what's Bhutan? Maybe some of us know about the country, maybe not. So Bhutan is this more right country just north of India and between India and China. Mostly in the Himalaya range. Bhutan is a country of mountains, forests, valleys, and that's all. Very isolated country, depending on India mostly for nearly everything, and depending on India for its income, because mostly the only income for Bhutan, economically speaking, is selling electricity to India. This country is a constitutional monarchy, which is on, actually, I would define on its way to democracy, but its own way, because the king of Bhutan is someone very clever about democracy. He wants his country to go very quickly to democracy, but the people don't want. That's kind of strange for us. They have a big respect for the king, for the kingdom, and actually they don't see the need for democracy. That's pretty strange. But the king wants to enforce that, and he just resigned on December 2006 in favor of his son. And to try and enforce more democracy. There will be free elections next year, and they go slowly and quietly and peacefully towards democracy. Bhutan is, well, one of the world's smallest economies, but probably one of the fastest growing. It's amazing to see development of information technology, especially in the capital city, Thimphu, which is the smallest capital city in the world, 30,000 people, and no single red light, traffic light. This is the only capital in the world without traffic light. Apparently, the king of Bhutan has an interesting definition of development, and it became quite famous over all over the world. Instead of defining the progress of a country in terms of national gross revenue, he defined this in terms of national gross happiness. And he became very famous because of this philosophy, quite Buddhist philosophy, sort of that. He's currently ranked in the top 100 people who have the most influenced the world in the last years, just over George Bush. The language in Bhutan is named Dzongkha. I hope I pronounce it well. This is a Tibetan, Sino-Tibetan family language, and you have here an example of the script, and I can't read it. Actually, I just grabbed a sample somewhere. I have no idea what it does mean, so I hope the friends watching over there will be able to tell us what it's supposed to mean. So Bhutan, okay, you know everything about Bhutan now. So why did Bhutan decide to go with free software? The main concern was there was no support for their national language by commercial vendors. Bhutan is very proud, very keen to preserve its culture and its language. The use of Dzongkha is enforced everywhere in the country by the king, people, at least the most literate people, speak a very good English. I felt ashamed speaking English with them because I suck at it. But they still have to use Zonka everywhere. It's kind of enforced by the law. So they have to support it in computing too. They made some initial attempts with commercial vendors, and of course the most famous one, with some disappointment. The recent version of Microsoft Vista is called to support Zonka. However, they made kind of a small mistake. They just call it Tibetan Bhutan. And people in Bhutan really don't like to be connected to Tibetan people. They have very close connection, of course, but they don't feel like Tibetan. This is a different culture and, moreover, a different language. They don't understand each other. So Dzongka is not Tibetan. So that was a big concern for Bhutan. So they decided to go their way with free software after wasting some money to get some support for Dzongka in Microsoft Windows product. The major motivation here is to be able to, The major motivation is to be able to modify sources to adapt for their language, for sources of software. So they decided to go with free software, with Linux. And why then did they decide to choose Debian? That's an interesting thing to hear about. The first motivation that Pema Gele gave to me when we talked about that is the robustness and our good established practice, our policy. I think the first word he mentioned me when talking about Debian was the policy. So apparently the policy is kind of a good thing to have. We have a big flexibility in our packaging process, which seems to be also interesting for them. They are not really concerned with something we hear often hear about Debian release not too often, have old software, etc. Blah 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 blah. Okay, having Firefox 1.0 whatever or Thunderbolt 1.0 whatever is not really a concern for them. It's okay. Outdated applications are not really a concern, and it's easy to work on localization in Debian. At least this is their feeling. I'm not sure they're right, anyway. So, how this Dzongka Linux built? Well, at first, it was a project to first begin with to prepare the ground to build a full distribution. The point was first to incorporate support for Dzongka in Linux, and mostly in application, of course, applications and users' application. But the point is to have a completely localized desktop system. So they work on technical issues related to rendering and input methods, which is a very common problem. Is all South Asia language support? They are all complex languages with many, many rendering and input issues. Do you want me to define the concept of complex language? I'm not the best specialist for that, but a complex language could be defined very easily to something that combines in whatever method. In Indic languages, so I have to be very careful about what I'm saying because I'm listened by some people in the Indic community here. You combine vowels with consonants, and this makes another grid. So you input one consonant, one vowel, and then it changes the glyphs. So that's basically the definition of complex language. You find these complex languages all over South and Southeast Asia, mostly. They needed to recruit translators. So actually they worked with college, particularly a college in Thimphu, the capital city, which is named the Cherukse College, to recruit translators. They also needed to define a common terminology for everything computer related. Which is a very common problem in language who don't have any computer terminology. So they did it the good way. First define the terminology, then work on translation and not start immediately to translate. And they localized end user applications, so Mozilla, OpenOffice.org, etc., etc. In 2006, they released the Debian Zonka Linux Live CD and installer, which consists on single CD, which can be run as a live CD and also install a full, completely localized system. It worked. They didn't use Debian as for the installer; wasn't ready at this moment, so they used Mofix installer, very easy to customize and translate, and they integrated application and their work to upstream. So their all translation work done on Mozilla, OpenOffice.org, etc., has been pushed to the upstream in Mozilla, OpenOffice, etc. And they assembled the CD. So this was launched on. Okay, so sorry for the photo, but you barely see nothing. So I will describe the photo. On June 2nd, 2006, which was very symbolic because this is the King's coronation anniversary, they launched Zonka Linux very officially. So on this picture, you actually see in the middle, around that would be the Ministry of Information of Bhutan, the Ministry of Education on the lower left, and some random guys are on the right. Well, okay, a few pictures to give you an idea of the attendance. It was a very official event. Actually, it was planned to have the Prime Minister, but he was not attending. So just to give you an idea of the importance given to this event, it was covered all over the country on TV and what, etc., newspaper. Okay, this is the official launch with Zonka Linux and the ministry picking up a t-shirt, this one actually. And yeah, I have my t-shirt for Zonka Linux. Then later on, after some talks we had during this launch, some training sessions happened in Thimphu, still the capital city. Franz Popp was invited to stay for 2 weeks around in Bhutan and give training session about DI customization, task cell customization, and Debian package building, and all this stuff that's needed to be a customized Debian distribution, a CDD by the way. And they worked on to modify task cell mostly. It was a very successful session. And in a few weeks, and on July 7th, it was supposed to happen on June 2nd, but they had to delay it, they will launch Zonka Debian Linux. So that will be entirely based on Debian Edge. They use a standard graphical installer, just customize the logo and etc. I wanted to set up a demo machine, but these crappy Dell machine actually do not boot the Debian graphical installer, so I couldn't be able to set up one. And Zonka Debian Linux is installable in English or Zonka. So on Zonka Debian Linux, everything is on one CD. It's not, as far as I know, it's not a live CD. There is a customized task cell, and they also have set up, it will be launched very, very soon. You've seen in the resources, they activated the website in advance, just for us. A full website, help infrastructure, and a Debian mirror. We will have to check whether this mirror is complete, but it would be nice to add it to the network of Debian Mirror, because listing just Bhutan in the list of Debian Mirror would be, in my opinion, quite great. There's a big effort in documentation. There are a lot of interesting end user documentation available in Zonka, because the target here is the end user. Monks in monasteries, schools, and every people, actually. So what they did up to now, they did some localization work on GNOME. Tonka Debian Linux is based on GNOME, OpenOffice.org, Mozilla Thunderbird, Firefox, and very important, as far as I saw over there, is Jane, because they like to chat over the internet, and you can actually chat with Jane in Zonka. That's very impressive to see. You can't do it with ERC, I don't think so. They also worked a lot on rendering engines, which is the basis for all these applications to work. There's support for Zonka in Pango, mostly targeted to GNOME, etc., and on ICU, targeted for the Mozilla family of products, as far as I know. If someone disagrees, please raise hands. What's most interesting, they always contributed back to both Debian and all free software projects. They contributed Zonka fonts, which are the one we use also in our own graphical installer. They contributed back their input methods, rendering engines, and also all their translations go upstream. That sounds pretty obvious, but this is really a philosophy they have to share back to the community. The future plans are to develop MD64 and PowerPC port. Splashboot. I heard things about Splashboots yesterday at the DIBOF meeting. So they, because here the argument is to just tell, well, you know, the farmer in his country, the teacher in a school lost in a valley somewhere, they want to have a nice boot, just this. So a nice splash boot, they want to do it with a whatever penguin with a monk suit wandering around the screen. They want to do more seriously countrywide training. There's a big program to do trainings of government officials. First, the ministry, the king, who changed. They have now the youngest king in the world, very clever with information technology. So I wouldn't be surprised that very soon the king of Bhutan uses Debian. The king of Bhutan runs Debian. The students, teachers, their students are also very clever about information technology. They are probably the students that travel the most over the world. The monks in the monasteries. Of course, Bhutan is a Buddhist cultural country, so everything related to Buddhism is very important, and copying and being able to keep sacred texts written in the Zonka script is very important all over the country. And the private IT vendors also. The development of IT is amazing in Thimphu. So these people need to be trained to use Zonka and not only based everything on English. So for instance, they plan to use in monasteries, and they really plan to use in monasteries. Pema told me that Zonka Linux is at least used in one monastery currently, not this one, which is the most famous one, the Taksan monastery. Just copy and keep track of sacred text. Well, why not imagine? They could print their prayer flags all over the mountains. You see prayer flags written by hand. And why not print them now with Zonka Linux? So there are a lot of plans actually to use this distribution. As I say, they did set up a lot of resources. Of course, I don't expect you to copy these resources, but it's quite interesting to see they have a brochures, manual in both in English and Zonka. What's interesting to see that what's DIT? DIT is the Department of Information Technology, the Ministry of Information of Bhutan, who is in charge of this project. And if you happen to go on the website of DIT, you'll see a lot of information about development of Zonka support in information technology. Actually, that's basically the talk. And this is the moment I say you could do some poll. to just thank you for attending. So here it's written Kuzu Zanpo. They also say Kuzu Zanpo to all the partners of this project, mostly international partners, the Department of Information, country partners first, the Department of Information Technology, the Department for the Development of Dzongkha, the Cheruze College, who most translators come from this this college in Thimphu, international partners, IDRC, International Development and Research for Cooperation, as far as I remember, based in Canada, who funded this project, and the PAN, so-called PAN localization project. Interesting to give a word about this project. This is funded by IDRC and it's aimed to develop the support for South Asia and Eastern Asia languages in computing. So it's all spread all over this country: Bhutan, Nepal, Pakistan, Thailand, several parts of India, as I remember. For instance, in parallel to Dzongkha Linux, a new distribution has been launched also, which is called Nepal Linux for Nepal, using the Nepal language named Nepali, which is surprisingly also based on Debian. So we actually rule the world over there. We are the best to support these languages. The developers are mentioned here, the translators, Pema Gere is in charge of the whole project, and he again apologized to not having been able to attend and talk to you about Dzongkha Linux much, much better than me. Okay. So all these people, really all these people, really want to thank the Debian project for all your work, all the hard work done, because this hard work gives the results of them being able to build their national customized distribution. So again, Kuzu Zanpo. And I think we can say them also, thank you. So would you like to try say Kuzu Zanpo to our Bhutanese people, our Bhutanese friends? Muchas gracias. Just for the, because everybody wants to see me in space, so for the fun during the question session, I just found a few pictures. Most of these pictures are courtesy of Franz Pop, more than me, because he stayed much longer than me over in the country. So if you have a question, please.
Well, actually just one question. If you look now back for this whole project, and do it at the beginning again, what would you have learned from it? Or did just everything work right as it was?
Can you repeat the question?
If you would
slower.
Okay, I'd like to. Actually, if you would start such a project now again, what would you do different? Or did just most things work so well that it was just, well, nothing to improve?
Yeah, so I tried to speak in name of Pema more in my own name, of course, because the project is theirs and not mine. I think they would probably start from the beginning. They would avoid this step using Morphix installer, which was very hacky and quite wacky, I think. They would, from the beginning, work with changes. Okay. Work with Debian maybe much more closer. They discovered quite late that we are quite involved in localization work and quite motivated to do it. So that would be probably the change, the main change they would do.
And from the Debian point of view, what could we have done better?
From the Debian point of view, what could we have done better? Maybe train or work on training session earlier, probably. It would have been good to have the training session with Franz Pop earlier so that they could more work on directly on Debian, because we have to spread the knowledge. And it's actually easy. You just need to find someone with enough skills, enough time, wanting to go 1 or 2 weeks over there in Bhutan. That's easy to achieve, because it's an amazing country. It's an amazing place. I don't know if the photo gave you an idea, but this is one of the countries in the world who cares the most for environment, for instance. They are covered with forest, and there are no projects to develop the use of forest. They just preserve the forest, and their only use for energy is hydroelectric electricity. There's a big concern over there for environment, just inside the ministry. Other questions? Animal, please, with the mic.
How many of them are in NN at the moment?
How many maintainers are currently in NN? Actually, zero. Pepa, at some moment, should enter new maintainer queue. That would be a little bit frightening for him if I can try speaking on his behalf. But I think, for my opinion, they definitely have the people for this. So it's just a matter of time, I think. Yeah, Jeremy?
I had a small camera first. Sometimes when you read a paper that talks about business paper that talks about free software, they're all always like talking about lowering the total cost of ownerships of servers and machines, etc. But this project is really interesting because finally you can see where free software actually helps to solve problems where like there's no money to make anyway, so like commercial models aren't interested. And I think like it's great to see when like free software can really help in this case. And I was curious about how did they like make contact with like did they like jump on IRC and said, hi, we're from Bhutan, we want to make our own distribution. What was this process actually?
Actually, I don't remember how we got in touch with the PEMA and others. It probably happened quite naturally because we tend to think that Bhutan is isolated and they have a low bandwidth, for instance, for internet. But they are not isolated at all. Most of the of their young people and students and literate people, they travel a lot. Most of the people I met over there are currently attending courses and doing studies in the US, or they went to Europe. I could speak French with a few people over there, so it's amazing to see how developed and how the country is going fast towards the information technology age. Because they are not very widely developed country, but not isolated, and there's a big will to just go this way, a big political will, especially by the king, the king's son, which is now very famous all over Asia, because the new king of Bhutan is very famous among all Thai girls because he's very nice looking. And yeah, I recommend him. With the all deep respect I owe to him, of course. So this is all this that makes, this happen. Free software, actually. This was the basis of the talk I had to give over there. This is just what we all people involved in free software are working for. We want this to achieve, and the best reward for us is to see that our work is used this way.
How well does Junker fit with software use for science? using Zonka for science and mathematics? Or would they use English?
That's quite a challenge to answer. I'm not really sure I have the answer. They probably plan to develop support for education material. First of all, the first need is to have tools to support the language, to teach it in schools. The point is to have support for the language, first learn language. The main danger for the language and culture is the invasion of English. It's very easy to speak English all the time in Thimphu City, because nearly everybody, or I wouldn't say everybody in the country, but probably everybody in the capital city is quite clever and very knowledgeable in English. So the main danger is Tonka to slowly disappear. I don't know if they have plans for higher education, for support in science, software, mathematics, and the like. That could be just a matter of doing it.
And Antis.
Will this have any effect on neighboring countries? This experience will have any effect on neighboring countries that will have to adopt the Debian?
I mentioned the development of Nepal Linux. Nepal Linux in Nepal did not develop because Bhutan did the thing. They both did this very same work in parallel. The people from Nepal Linux were invited at the launch. So this doesn't have any effect, but this is the same movement of all over South Asia, actually, to develop their own national solution based on free software. India is, of course, a good example. A huge country, 1 billion people, 20 or so official languages, and most of them not supported by commercial products, or badly supported, or whatever. So India, there are many, many programs all over India in the states to develop localized distributions in Tamil, in Malayalam, Gujarati, I don't know. Many of them, Karunaka, who is listening to us, could probably tell more about this. So this is quite a general movement. Quite similar to the one you have in Latin America, but with different motivation. Here, the language support.
Yes, in Latin America, we have countries that are very isolated, like Cuba. And we also have countries like Venezuela that are adopting Debian very quickly.
So yeah, I think these are the very future of free software. So maybe DevConf 20 will be organized in Bhutan or so.
Yeah.
Well, okay, if you listen to me, just prepare. We've got time for one question if you still want.
You mentioned the plans for educational software. Are you? Do you know if they are aware of the Debian EDU project? And do you have the list of actors we should add to our DVDs to add this language to our set of support languages?
So, question was: are they aware of Debian EDU? And yes, now. That was one of the points of them asking me to come. It was to talk about the general movement of free software. And I remember mentioning Debian Edu efforts during my talk, if I remember well. So it's just a matter of getting in touch, I think, either from their side or from the Debian Edu side. That would be a lot of work, probably, because again, localization and support for this input method, complex language. There's a lot of work, but they are definitely interested. The two ministers who attended the launch were the Minister of Information and Technology and the Minister of Education.
So
just call them.
To enable the input methods, it's more complex than for Japanese, because according to Kai Henry, it was just to install a few packages, and we already did that, so.
I think that's more complex than Japanese. yes, just need a few people, specialists of this, and there are a lot of them all over this part. Still, I'll mention again, Guttupalli Karunaka, who's one of the best well-known specialists of these things in free software. It's just a matter of getting in touch with him and just bring him somewhere. He came to Extremadura to the internationalization meeting. So there are the people, there are the projects, just a matter to start in all the stuff. Okay, I think we're running out of time, so thank you again for your attention, and just come to Bhutan someday.